Okay, so let us start with the last part of our course, that is Verilog HDL program. So our course says that it has got 5 hours of something of Verilog, but actually, truly speaking, programming is always endless. It's always endless. So that's where we need to do more and more projects on this particular part and go ahead with this thing. Now, as far as an electronics engineer is concerned, this particular programming language is very important. Very, very important means very important. So let me give you a brief of what this kind of programming is actually. So you can see here that I have written Verilog HDL. Can somebody confirm? Shubham, can you just confirm my voice, whether you are getting it or not? Shubham, just a minute. I need to adjust. Can you just confirm again?
Yeah, so the voice is clear.
And the screen is visible, right?
Yes, sir.
So Verilog is basically a hardware description language. Okay, so out of this Verilog HDL means HDL stands for Hardware Description Language. Now the question is whether Verilog is the only hardware description language. So the answer is no. Not the only one. So, which is the other hardware description language? So, the other hardware description language is something called as VHDL. So, it also means the same thing, but it has got slightly different way of programming. Now, Verilog is pretty close to C programming language, is pretty close to C programming language. So let me just tell you something about this. I will say like C program, because till now either you must have done some kind of C or maybe Python or Java. So these are the three different programming languages which you might have encountered till now. You might have written programs in C, you might have written programs in Python, you might have written programs in Java. So just for discussion's sake, I'm going to ask few questions to selected students. Okay, let's start with Shubham itself. Shubham, can you unmute for a while?
Yes, sir.
Shubham, can you tell us which kind of programs you wrote when you did C programming? Just few examples, I mean,
Like
numeric
addition.
addition, then have you done some matrix multiplication?
Yes.
Have you done some, what do you call it? Have you written some functions?
Yes, functions.
So basically, you write a function and you call it whenever you want. And then there are concepts like concatenation or encapsulation, friend function, and so on. So these are some very typical things in C or C++. So this programming, Verilog, is something similar to these kind of programs. So for example, you write in C and then you write probably hello, then you just close it and then you put a colon. So when I say it is like C, that means whenever you write some statement, you put a colon out after it. That means you want the compiler to understand that this particular line is a one statement and the end of statement is given by the colon. So colon indicates end of statement. So similarly, when it comes to Verilog, you will find that after writing a statement, we will put a colon, just as we do in C or Java or Python. Here, please understand, Verilog is not C programming. Verilog is not Python programming. Verilog is not Java programming. So what, how different Verilog is from these programming techniques? So like I said, that Verilog is a hardware description language. It describes the hardware that you want to implement. So that is something new in this thing. In while you write C program, so when you write C program, you just write int a, b, c, and then you just write a is equal to b plus c, and both a, b, and c are integers. So that's how you write it. But here, we don't declare int, float, and such things when we do Verilog. We declare, we work with very raw kind of data. That means my data, whether it is integer or floating, at the end of the day, it can be represented using decimal numbers. It can be represented using octal numbers. It can be represented using hexadecimal numbers. So we, when we actually go to the circuit level, there is no int and float. There is a circuit which is going to process this kind of data, and that data which is coming can be given in decimal, can be given in hexadecimal, can be given in octal, or whatever the data types that we have studied in the initial part of the course. This is basically, like I'm again saying, it's a hardware description language. So it is a general purpose hardware description language that is similar in syntax to C programming, and it is comparatively easier to use as compared to C programming. So there are no higher level programming involved like in C. Verilog and VHDL are basically the two programming languages. So generally what happens is that some programming languages are more towards software and some programming languages are more towards hardware. So what is the meaning of this? The meaning of this is these programming languages which are more towards software are called as high level programming languages, and which are more towards hardware are called as low level. So high level and low level doesn't indicate the complexity of programming. It indicates the level of programming. That means which is closer to the hardware and which is closer to the software. So Verilog is a programming which is closer to the hardware. And VHDL is a programming which is not very close to the hardware. What is the meaning of close to hardware and close to software? That means when we say close to hardware, means when you are programming, you should know what is the hardware available to implement a given circuit. For example, if you want to implement A is equal to B dot C plus D dot A. So you can see that there are two dots. So you will require two AND gates and one OR gate. Now, to implement this using a program, first you should know whether two AND gates and one OR gate is available or not to do the programming. Whereas when you do the same thing in C, you really don't, it doesn't really matter to you whether these gates are available or not. So Verilog is actually used to program the hardware. To program the hardware means what? Verilog is used to program the hardware, meaning hardware is in excess, hardware is in excess. We use some parts, or I will say components. Components can be wires, components can be gates, components can be flip-flops, components can be MUX, DMUX, or parts or components. Out of this excessive hardware, choose some and when we say program hardware, when we say we program the hardware, what does it mean? We are doing proper or the required wiring, proper or the required wiring. So this is what we are actually doing when we are saying program the hardware. Programming the hardware is possible by describing the hardware. That is why we say hardware description is required, and the language in which we provide the description of the hardware is called as the hardware description language. So Verilog is a very dedicated language to describe the hardware. So first, we need to, we have some hardware. So in this we may have gates, we may have MUX, DMUX, whatever. So we have to do the right connections. So program this and then give test inputs. Give test inputs. See output. See output. So where this Verilog programming is done? Where is this Verilog programming is done? Let us say that I tell you to design a circuit. Giving, so I gave you some very random function, y is equal to a plus b dot c plus d the whole bar plus f, something of this sort, something very random. Now you want to actually test this particular performance before you actually make an IC out of it. So actually we will never go for a FPGA or a CPLD chip directly, but we will generally test our hardware on FPGAs, that is the programmable gate arrays, And then once we feel that, okay, whatever logic I have designed is correct, then you go for manufacturing the ICs. So actually, how this Verilog is used in the industry. So I will just write one page here. Use of Verilog in the industry. How this is used. Okay. So first we gather requirements. First we gather the requirements. That is, we find out what is the circuit that we have to make, how many inputs will it have. So requirements as in how many inputs, how many outputs, how many registers, just in case you want to momentarily store the output, you may require registers. Then after you take the requirements, you use CAD tool. You use a CAD tool. Now this CAD tool can be, so there are many. So we have got Xilinx, we have Altera, we have got Vivado, and so on. All these are licensed. Mind it, it's licensed. Our college has got Xilinx, okay, Xilinx 14 version. So we pick any one of these tools, Xilinx, Vivado, Altera. So we will pick up Xilinx. So our CAD tool is going to be Xilinx. And then we write, using the CAD tool, we create a Verilog code. We create a Verilog code. Now, where all we have created Verilog code? So please recollect, when we made circuits in digital schematic was giving me a Verilog code. So what you were specifying to generate the Verilog code, what all things you were specifying? So first you were giving schematic. Schematic was getting converted to Verilog code. Schematic means you were actually picking up gates, flip-flops, etc., etc. from the palette, and you were making a circuit out of it. You were doing the connections and you were generating the code. But in Xilinx, you can skip this step. In Xilinx, you can skip this step. So what they thought is, to implement, to actually draw a schematic, you have to do some calculations, right? So with the help of those same calculations, why draw schematic? You can directly draw Verilog code, because that is the code that is going to be used to test the given circuit. Now, after making the Verilog code of the given circuit, so what you have written in the Verilog code? You have written probably the behavior. You might have given the structure, or you might have given how gates are connected. So you might have written this, either behavior, structure, or how gates are connected. So that is why in Verilog we have three types of techniques. One is called as the behavioral model, one is called as the structural model, and other one is called as the gate level modeling. So we will come to that. So after creating Verilog code, you want to, so Verilog code is a way of specifying, I will also write here, way of specifying hardware connections. Okay, now you have specified how you want to connect the hardware. So now, you have to create the hardware. Create the hardware. So now you will create the hardware. But create the hardware on what? That is the question. So just chapter number 5 speaks about programmable devices. So you can create the hardware on PLA, you can create on PAL, you can create on CPLD, you can create on FPGA. And today we have, so this is called as field programmable gate array. So FPGA is completely digital, and latest one is called as FPAA. Actually, this is not there for you, but many of my students are working with this. That is called as field programmable analog array. Instead of a digital array, we can also have amplifiers, power amplifiers, clipper, clamper, etc., etc. Whatever you have studied in EDC, all those things can come inside, because hardware can be digital or analog. So why always it should be digital? It can be analog also. So FPAA programming can also be done using this Verilog. So we choose one of this. In our lab, we have got FPGA, which is Spartan series of Xilinx and version 6. Spartan series of Xilinx, which is support, that is version 6. We also have Spartan 3. So if you want to play around, Spartan 3 also is very much sufficient. So if you want to completely write a processor or an ALU, you can develop it on Spartan 3 also, but we have got Spartan 6. Now, Spartan 3 and Spartan 6, what would be the difference? The difference would be in the amount of hardware available for programming. So ideally, we want a lot of hardware at our disposal so that we can write any program and create the circuit. Now, once you create the hardware, you have to test the hardware. So testing is done by creating something called as a test bench. Now, after is giving test vectors to this hardware. So once you created the hardware, you gave it test vectors. So once test vectors are given, you can tweak this hardware. You can again go back, do some changes in the Verilog code, again burn the hardware, again give some test vectors. So this step number 1, 2 and 3 can be done repeatedly. So step number 1, 2 and 3 can be done repeatedly till you get the correct output. Now, once you feel that, okay, your output is good enough, that means now your hardware is ready. My hardware that I have designed is working as per my requirements. So once you are ready with that, so once your hardware is okay, now you say that commercially FPGA is very expensive. Commercially FPGA is very expensive. What is the meaning of this expensive? So I will talk in terms of your language only. So currently we have a AMD Ryzen 5 series processors and Ryzen 7 series processor. These are the fastest processors. I am not doing any publicity of AMD or Intel, but yes, these processors are much faster than Intel processors. So we have something called as the 5600 series and 3600 series. The difference is only the cache memory and some improvement in clock. So these processors come at around 21,000 to 25,000. That's the cost of the processor. Okay. So of course, cost in rupees. But if you want to have an FPGA, if you want a FPGA, which has got the same number of transistors and everything inside it. So we have FPGA. So some of the latest series are Kintec series or Arctic series. These kind of series are there. So this would cost you something like around 75,000. So that's the difference in the hardware. You can see that FPGAs are three times costlier even than a microprocessor. Now the reason for that is FPGA has got excess hardware. So I already told you that FPGA has got an excess hardware. Things are in excess so that you can do the programming that you want, and that is the reason why this cost is there. But okay, so what designers do is designers buy this FPGA, only one FPGA, and it is reprogrammable. Today I make one circuit, tomorrow I make some other circuit. So I keep on making circuits and I keep on making these Verilog codes. So once my hardware is perfectly tested, I can also say my Verilog code for that hardware is also ready. Now what I do is, since the cost is very high and I want to make this in huge quantities, I have to leave Verilog and move to something called as ASIC design, that is application specific integrated circuits. So this is called as ASIC design. So for doing ASIC design, you should know something called as cadence or Mentor graphics or Synopsys. These are the tools that we generally use. So the input to the cadence, so you designed something in Verilog, you tested something in Verilog, but now I want to do things like power plan. I want to lay power supply lines because each and every circuit will require power supply. I want to do parasitic estimations. So whether there are any RC effects or not, because R into C is time delay. So I don't want any time delay to come into the picture. So I want to do some processes like layout versus schematic, that is LVS. Then I want to do something called as floor plan. So when I'm making an IC, I need to plan everything inside. Floor plan means now each and every circuit requires a clock, because if there are counters, if there are flip-flops and so, and all of these circuits require, so clock should be close to all the circuits, and ideally it should be at the center of the circuit. So I need to do something called as floor plan. So that is something there. So just like your house, you know, your main entrance is in the hall. Somebody doesn't enter your house through your bedroom. So something similar. So clock needs to be at a position where it is accessible to all. So these are certain steps which we have to do. And the input and all this is given. So Verilog code will have the description of the hardware. Verilog code will have the description of the hardware. And additionally, I want to do power plan, I want to do parasitic estimation, I want to do layout versus schematic, I want to do floor planning, and I want to do many other things which are available. So together, now this plus this, I can do in a software called as Cadence. So we have this software in our lab, that is Cadence Virtuoso Tools. So our students are designing adders, high speed adders. They are designing adders with different devices, that is MOSFETs, FinFETs, and different things. And they are testing the speed of this particular circuit. So I can also add speed, I can also add area, so I can also add power dissipation. So I want to see how much is the power dissipation and so on. So all this is possible in Cadence, but the description of hardware is already available in Verilog. So I can give my input file to Cadence. So Cadence will again build the hardware with the help of Verilog file, and then it will generate a circuit where you can do all these things. So this is how the Verilog tool is actually used in the industry. Now comes to the why you should actually learn Verilog programming and give more importance to Verilog than probably even Python. That is because after doing Python, you will end up in signal processing. So you will do more of signal processing. You would easily go into AI and ML. And by the time you pass out, I think there will be not thousands, but millions of people who will be hungry for these kind of jobs. And the pay packages as on date is around 3 to 4 lakhs for a Python programmer. So once you do become a Python programmer, you would work in ML and AI, and I would say in short, you would do signal processing. Okay, and all the related things. But if you are a Verilog designer, your salary package would be something like that is the starting. And what you would be actually doing is, you would be doing AI, ML, signal processing, everything by building your own hardware which can actually do all these things and do all these kind of analysis. So these points which I have written here, power plan. So there is something called as a power plan engineer in AMD. His work is to only look after how power supply and ground lines can reach all the different circuits inside without causing any electromagnetic effects which are present because of the laying of wires inside. So that person will do only that much and he will fetch the value that I have written below. Then there is one engineer called as LVS. He does only layout versus schematic. One engineer will do only floor planning. One of the engineers will do only clock designs. So one of my friends, his name is Shravan Lakshman, and he is a senior manager at AMD who works in clock designs. So even he tells me that you need to be only good in Verilog. I mean, if you are good at Verilog, welcome to Intel or AMD. That is what they say. So you should know Verilog and VHDL, either one of them, very thoroughly. Verilog allows different levels of abstraction to be mixed in the same model. A designer can define hardware model in terms of switches, gates, RTL, or behavioral code. There are two methodologies in Verilog. There are two methods in Verilog. Methodology. So there are two methodologies. The first one is called as top down. Top down means you just say, I want to make a black box which will have some inputs and some outputs. Let's say it has got 7 inputs and 4 outputs. And inputs are related to outputs in this particular way. That means if I give here 0101101, my output should be 1101, something like this. So you specify the inputs and you say this should be the output. Now the CAD tool has to calculate what is going to be there in this black box. That is called as top-down approach. So in top-down, the top level block is defined and necessary sub-blocks are identified to build the top level blocks. The sub-blocks are subdivided until the leaf cells cannot be divided. That means this, we say, okay, to implement this, we require one counter plus 3 gates. So 3 gates are fine. Now counter will have, let's say, four flip flops plus gates. So gates are fine. So we cannot go below a gate, but flip flop will have four into, let's say, some more 10 gates. So this is called as a top down approach. So ultimately you require gates, gates and gates. So this entire circuit will be gates, but you are coming from top to down. So what you will reach is a leaf cell, which cannot be divided further, which is basically a gate. So this is called as a leaf cell. If you start a tree, the lowest that you can go up to is a leaf. You cannot divide a leaf. Similarly, this is called as a top-down approach. So we also have something called as a bottom-up approach. So we have something called as a bottom-up approach. So what we do in bottom-up? I think the entire course of digital design was administered to you in bottom-up approach only. That means, first we started with gates. With gates, we made mux, demux, and so on. With the gates itself, we conceptualized our flip-flops. With flip-flops, we conceptualized our counters. And so on. So we start with the basic entity, that is the gate, and then we build upon it. So that is called as a bottom-up approach. So in the bottom-up design methodology, the available building blocks are identical. The bigger cells are built by these building blocks, and these cells are then used for making higher level blocks. So this is something that we have to understand. So this was all about the basic and why we should go for Verilog, why Verilog programming is important, where we can use it, and so on. So if you want to apply for a job at Intel Bangalore, you should be excellent in Verilog and either C or Python. So that is the requirement. So any questions till this point, in this place, regarding the perspective, scope, or whatever doubts you have? I can see that one question has come by Sanmesh Shintre. Sir, what is the difference between overclocked CPU and normal CPU? Okay, so Sanmesh, when you buy a CPU, let's say when you say AMD Ryzen 5, when you say this, and when they say 3600, they will print a processor speed that is 4.2 gigahertz. Okay. Now, this CPU can actually work at 4.4 gigahertz, but only for some time. Only for some time. So that is what they specify in the specification. Now, this overclocking may be required when you are doing parallel processing. That means when you are processing big images, or you are dividing a big image into smaller parts and processing each image separately. So in MATLAB, you have a facility of overclocking the CPU, but you cannot use this overclocking feature on a motherboard which is A320M. It is not designed for overclocking. Not designed for overclocking. So you need to change the spec to B, I think it's B450M. So for this, so this supports overclocking. So it is not just the processor which is actually overclocking, it is also the motherboard. I hope I have been able to at least throw some light on what do you mean by overclocking. At rated speed, it will always work at 4.2 gigahertz, and only during special instances, we can use it at 4.4 gigahertz. Okay. So good, you reminded me of speed. Even FPGAs can work at different speeds. So FPGAs can work at different speeds, like 3.8 gigahertz or 3.6 gigahertz and so on. Okay. So any questions till this point, please unmute and ask. Any questions before I actually start getting into the programming terms? Any more questions about why to do Verilog and what is the actual use of it? Yes, anybody wants to just unmute and ask the question?
Sir, what is the need for Verilog programming? Like, we also have other languages like C and others. So why Verilog is different than other languages?
I told you that's because it's a dedicated HDL. Okay, so I'll tell you something like this. Okay, let's say that, it is very difficult to switch from one language to another language. For example, if you are working in C, you might not want to shift to other language because the syntax changes, the way of writing the lines changes, the way you define a matrix in C, the way you define a matrix in MATLAB, the way you define a matrix in all different languages change. So these are the reasons why you would not like to change. Now what happens is that some people do very dedicated work. That means they do only hardware programming. Some people do, let's say they want to build hardware for specific application or specific processing. For this thing, what we actually need to do is we may have to use HDL plus C, something like this. We may have to use HDL plus C. Another important factor is HDLs, hardware description languages, support reprogramming. So reprogramming is very important. You know, in which applications reprogramming would be important? So in space applications. Even if you want to replace a toothbrush on the space platform, it is very expensive because you need to launch a rocket for that. So in case of failure on space platforms, what they do is they, instead of using ASICs, that means ICs which are used for a specific application, they go for FPGAs, that means reprogrammable hardware. So what happens is they get a facility of correcting the fault from the ground station just by uploading the new hardware which is required to correct the problem. So in that sense, HDL becomes very dedicated in such kind of applications. There are some more applications like edge computing. So what happens is let us say that you have you want to measure radiation levels near border areas, but you don't want the actual level. You want only whether the level is high, medium or low. You want to do this. So this involves acquisition of data from many sensors. So unlike a ASICS, so a microprocessor will have around 80 pins. But an FPGA or a programmable hardware would have somewhere up to 150 pins. And that too programmable. You can define whether these pins are input or output. So in these applications where you want to specifically play with the hardware, there we go for hardware description languages. And where you want to only process the signal, that is, when once the signal acquisition is done, you only want to process it. In those kind of environments, you can go only for Python or C. So let's say I have got a FPGA and I have got around 10 sensors connected to this. And FPGA is acquiring the data. It is giving it to a microcontroller. And then it is being given to some transmitting circuit, TX, and then it is being transmitted over some communication link to the base station. So that is what is actually happening. So the flow is something like this. Now let's say that these 10 sensors are connected in a certain fashion to the FPGA, and now you want to change that particular fashion. That means generally the nodes are connected in ring configuration. So these are, when you do a communication network problem, they are connected in ring configuration or they are connected in star configuration. So if you want to reprogram these, that is the way in which the sensors are connected to the microcontroller, then you have to only change the hardware and not anything on the microprocessor. So in that sense, you have to use only hardware description language and not do anything with the microprocessor. So that's the reason why hardware description language needs to be studied separately. If you try to do it with C, then you may have to program both microcontroller as well as FPGA. So that's the problem. So that's how things are done. So FPGA can have its own transmitter here. You can send a correction signal here directly. FPGA reprograms and starts sending the correct data to the transmitting station. So this is a very specific language where you are dealing with changing the hardware. I hope I have been able to throw at least some light on why HDL is important. And it is not the only best language, but yes, it is important. So now what MATLAB has done is, MATLAB combined all this together. You can write everything in MATLAB. And MATLAB will have an HDL compiler in it. MATLAB will have a C compiler in it. So you write a code in MATLAB. If you want to put it on the FPGA, use the HDL compiler. It will give you a Verilog code. That Verilog code you can drop on the FPGA. If you want to control the microcontroller, okay, you can compile, write again the code in MATLAB, use a C compiler, convert the code to C and reprogram this thing. So over a period of time, the way in which we program the hardware has also evolved. And that is the reason why the programming languages also have evolved in that sense. So at this level, Verilog programming is very important for you, because you may have to learn layouts, you may have to learn IC design. You have not yet reached that level. How to make all these things small. So you are doing two courses. One is ADC, other one is DLDA. ADC is analog, DLC is digital. Now the question is how to make all these things small. So that you will study in VLSI. And VLSI will again talk about Verilog and all these languages. So we are now in the actually the intermediate step. So with time, I think this question will become even more clear. Okay, so Karthik, should I go ahead?
Yes, sir. I got it. I got your point.
Yeah, if somebody else has a question, I can take one more question so that we can go ahead. Okay, so let's start the actual programming with Verilog. So before we come to a program, let's see whether we can come to the actual program today or not. But before we go to a program, we should know certain definitions. So the first definition is of a module. So you all can start writing this. The first definition is of a module. A module is the basic building block in Verilog. So even if you want to define a gate, you have to define a gate module. If you want to define a flip-flop, you have to define a flip-flop module. If you want to define a counter, you have to define a counter module. A module can be an element or a collection of lower level design blocks. That means, let us say a module can be of an AND gate. So we can define a module in this way. Module underscore name of that module. So name, if you are designing an AND gate, so I will write here AND gate, module underscore AND gate. If we are designing a flip-flop, so I will write here module underscore. Now flip-flops are also having types, D flip-flop, JK flip-flop. So let's say I'm designing a D flip-flop. So I'll write D flip-flop, something like this. So this helps us to identify a port which is there in that particular module. So generally, the module is used in this way. So it is naming. This is how the naming is done. This is the way of naming, but generally we would write it in this fashion. So first we would write module underscore whatever is the module name that is the module underscore name module underscore name, and then in bracket you will write the port list. Port list. So this is something that you will write in the bracket, and then you will put a colon. Then we can have some more statements inside the module, so some more details. So I will call it as module internals. So these are some module internals. And after you make the module, after all the things in the module are defined, we can write end module. Please note, there is no space between end and module. Everything is close. It is end module. Now, what is the meaning of this? So let's see, just besides this, now I am defining an AND gate. I am defining an AND gate, a two input AND gate. Two input AND. So the module for this would be module underscore, I will say AND gate, module underscore AND gate into bracket. There are two inputs, so I will write A and B, and every gate has got one output, so I will write it as Y. Module underscore AND gate into bracket A B comma Y. So that is what I will write. Then you can see on the screen we have module internals. We have what? Module internals. So by writing this line, you wrote that I am trying to design a module. By writing this first line, you said, I am trying to design a module whose name is AND gate. It has got two inputs, A and B, and it has got one output, Y. So, in this particular line, we have not actually said which are inputs and which are outputs. We don't know. So that is why just below the module, we have to write input. Out of these three, the inputs are A and B, semicolon, end of line. The output is Y. So input and output are keywords. Input and output are keywords. So now you are saying that, okay, first I only knew that I made a box and there were three pins, A, B and Y. But by writing these two lines, input A, B and output Y, we are now saying A and B are inputs and Y is the output. A and B is the input and Y is the output. So first line indicates that we made a module whose name is A and B, and it has got three pins, A, B, comma Y. But which are inputs, which were outputs, not known. So now we defined A and B are input and Y is output. But yet we don't know what is the relationship between A, B and Y. So the relationship is unknown. This relationship is unknown. And that is where you have to define the relationship by using another keyword that is called as assign. That is called as assign Y. So this is the symbol for assignment. Assign Y less than or equal to. So basically it's like an arrow. Assign the value of Y to A and B. So A and B, out of this, AND is an operator. This is the assignment operator and this is the keyword. So now we establish the relationship between input and output by using the keyword assign. So Y is assigned the value of A and B. Y is assigned the value of A and B. And finally, after assigning this value, of course you have to put a semicolon, otherwise the compiler will give an error. So that is not a problem. If it gives an error, we can always put a semicolon, but end of the sentence should always be a semicolon. And here, we will write AND module. So you can see that these module internals are actually, this is one model internal, this is the second, and this is the third. So this is what we mean by a model. Of course, there are many examples. So please note down this example of an AND gate. How module is used to define an AND gate. How the word module is used. Once you are done with this, just write done in the chat box.
Hello. Hello.
So there is a slight echo from your side. Can you? I think you are on two devices. Can you turn off or be mute on one of the device?
Hello?
Yes, Akshay. Yes, Akshay, I can hear you. Go on.
Sir, you assigned the value of A and B to Y, but why did you write Y is less than or equal to?
Yes.
Yeah, so I mean, while assigning, we should write Y equals to A and B, no?
No. So that's what I said, that this is the assignment operator. Oh. Okay, so I'll tell you the reason for that. Okay, that's a very good question actually, Akshay. You can see that here there is an assignment operator. Okay, that is less than or equal to, and here you are having a logical operator. AND is a logical operator, and this is assignment. Okay, so when we use less than or equal to with the help of an assign statement, it will consider it as an assignment operator. Akshay, are you listening to this? If we use
yes, sir.
Less than or equal to with the help of assign, then it will use it as an assignment operator. So I'm coming to this, but if I use a if statement, if y is less than or equal to a, if I use like this, so here the statement is if, here the statement is assign. So when you use if, that is a condition, then it takes it as a less than or equal to in the literal sense. Did you get this?
Yes, sir.
So that is how the same symbol, that is less than or equal to, can be used in two different ways by specifying outside which statement are you actually trying to use, whether you are using a case statement, if statement, or a assign statement.
Okay, sir, I got it.
Yeah. Yes, any doubts, you go on. Because programming is something that you should know more. And though I will be ending this tomorrow formally, but programming goes on infinitely. Today also I am doing programming in very long after so many years of spending in this teaching profession. So it is absolutely endless, and projects are done mainly using this particular language. So I will be floating a VAC that is a value added course specially on Verilog programming after your exams somewhere in the month of January or something. So if you want to do more on this, more projects and all, then you can definitely join that. Okay, so let's go ahead to something called as data types. Let's go to something called as before even we go to data types, I want to ask you a question. I am writing a code now here. Module underscore Akshay A B C Y input is A B C output is Y assign Y is equal to A Can anybody tell me? I have defined a block Akshay. There are three inputs A, B, and C, and there is one output. A, B, and C, as you can see, they are inputs, and Y is the output. Can you tell me which gate Akshay is representing?
Three input AND.
Akshay is representing a which AND gate? Three input AND gate. Who is answering this question? I could not get you. Yes, how many input AND gate?
Three input AND gate,
that is right. Okay, so I'll do some more changes in this now. So I have defined a module name. Sorry for the spelling, Tanish. Okay.
Okay.
And I did like this. This is which gate? Now Tanish is representing which gate? It is a NAND gate because that this sign is the negation sign. So I am coming to all these signs. This sign is called as the negation. So negation of A and B and C. So Tanish is a, this module is a three input NAND. So you can expect such questions in the oral. That is, I will write something on the screen and I'll just ask you, what is this module actually doing? So you should be able to say that. Okay. Anyways, so we will see more of this. So actually, you should never write such things like Tanish. You should not give your own name. You should actually write here what? You can actually write here 93. You can write 93 into bracket ABC like that. Okay, so and so this name should actually say it all when you look at this particular function. Okay, let's go to data types. So data types are having two or more things inside it. So there are mainly three types of data types. So first is the actual value. So when it comes to data types, we have value levels. Many times the gates are connected using wires, or they are also called as nets. And then many times we need to register the output. That means hold on to the output. So we have registers. So as far as the values are concerned, the values can be something like this. So we have 0, then we have 1, then we have don't care, and then we have Z. So this is okay. This is logic 0, or can be treated as a false condition. This is logic 1, and this can be treated as a true condition. This is unknown logic. Unknown to you, but it is actually connected to 0 or 1, and this is floating. This Z is called as floating, or it is also called as high impedance. So why it is called as high impedance, I'll just give you an example. Let's look at a mux, a 2:1 mux. This is your control signal, S0. So if S0 is 0, Y is connected here. So this is your, let's say, I0 and I1, input line 1 and input line 2. So if S0 is 0, this is the condition. And if S0 is 1, then Y is connected to I1. But what I0 and I1 are, that we don't know. Whether I0 is 0, 1, X or Z, not connected to anything. So it may happen that you have connected this to ground, and this point you have not connected to anything. It is not connected to VCC. It is not connected to even ground. This point is not connected to any of it. It's just floating. So when S is 0, Y will be connected to a point which is floating. So that is why we say Z. That is not connected to VCC, neither connected to ground. And when S0 is 1, that time Y is going to be 0. So this is how a floating state may be possible in the case of digital circuits. And that is why, since the floating state can be very much be possible, we should to define that state in digital design. That is why the different states which are defined in digital design are logic 1, logic 0, very common. We have been using that since long. Don't care also we have been using. So please recollect, don't care means either 0 or 1. That is why in the K-maps also, we had the liberty to group it with 0, or we had the liberty to group it with 1 according to our convenience. Because whatever it is, it was either connected to logic 0 or 1. And Z means neither connected to logic 0 nor connected to 1, that is VCC. That is the meaning of Z, high impedance. So any doubts in this, please ask. This is high impedance states are specifically possible when you are using circuits like MUX and DMUX, because MUX and DMUX, what they do is they only connect the input lines to the output. So as such, there is no reference to ground. That is the reason why we may expect some high impedance states when it comes to MUX. Okay. Next is wires. That is, the declaration is also named as wire. The declaration of wires is so wire is declared as wire like this. So when we do a program, I will show you how to use this wire. So for example, let's see how a wire declaration is made. Let's say we have a gate A and B. And this is connected to, this is the output, that is C, and this is the Y, final output, and this is, let's say, D. So actually this is input, this is also input, this is output of the first gate, and this is the final output. So actually speaking, you can see A, B and D are the actual inputs to this circuit. This C is an intermediate, so this there is a connection from the output of the AND gate to the input of this OR gate. So that connection, we can define it as wire C, because C is neither an input nor an output. C is neither an input, neither an output. It is an intermediate value of the signal, but each and everything has to be defined. That is why we define this as wire C. So as far as the program is concerned, we can just go to the next slide. I'll just redraw this here. We have A, B, this has C. And this is D. And this is your final one. So when we are actually declaring the module, A, B and D, they are inputs. Y is the output. But you can see this connection between the output of the first AND and the input of the next OR is not defined properly. So we have to define this C. So how will I write this? I will write module underscore, I will just write logic function has got, how will I write this? I will write A, B, D and Y, A, B, D and Y, that's how I'll write it. So please write with me, we'll write it together. First, draw this circuit. So I will write here input is A, B, D, output is Y, and I will write wire C, wire C. Then I will write and the AND gates, that is the inputs are A, B and output is C, and for the OR gate the input is C, D and output is. And then I'll write AND module. So this way of writing this circuit, the way of writing this circuit in this fashion is called as gate level modeling. Gate level modeling. Why it is called as gate level modeling? Because as far as the circuit is concerned, you can see only two gates, AND and OR gate. Each gate has got some input and some output. And in the module, I just defined what is the input and output of each and every gate. And it is very much evident from the program itself that the output of AND is one of the inputs of the OR. So as simple as that. So that is why this is called as gate level module. Alternatively, if I did not want to use this wire, if I did not want to use this, then I could have also written this program in this function, this way. I would have written it this way. I would write module underscore logic function. I would have written A, B, D and Y. That means I am defining a block. It has got four pins, A, B, D and Y. When I write input A, B and D, that means what am I doing? I am saying that out of these four, these three are input, and when I write here output Y, I am saying that this Y is the output. And instead of using this wire and gate level modeling, I can directly do a assign statement here. I can say assign Y the value of, so what is this Y actually? This Y will be D plus A and B. So assign the value of Y as D plus A and B. And then I would write AND module. Then I would write what? AND module. So this approach is called as, so this was called as gate level modeling, and this is called as data flow approach. This is called as data flow approach. There is one more kind of modeling. There is one more. So that is called as behavioral modeling is called as behavioral modeling. Behavioral means we actually say something like this, that what is the value of if. So behavioral will always have something called as a begin statement case, something like that. And in that you specify if there are three inputs A, B and D, then there are 8 combinations possible. So you define each and every combination, for which combination what output you want, you define that. That is also enough to build the circuit. So for behavioral approach, you should know the truth table of the circuit. Please write this, two approaches for the same circuit. So if I want to do gate level modeling, we should know connection between gates. So we should know which are the inputs and outputs of each gate. If we are doing a data flow approach, then we should know what this final function is. So final function should be known. And when you are doing a behavioral approach, what you should know is the truth table of the circuit. Now you just see that for the given circuit, is truth table possible? Yes. I am sure that everybody of you can make the truth table of this given circuit A, B, D, and then from that you can make the truth table Y. So you can, just by looking at the truth table, you can implement a behavioral implementation. But by looking at this circuit, some people may also say that, okay, there is a OR gate and A, this is A, and so what C is actually A and B. So Y would be D plus A and B. So some people will naturally see this, that okay, this is actually a data flow, or the final function is this. So if you know the final function also, you can write a program. And some people may see how they are connected. They may not know what is the behavior, they may not know what is the truth table, they are just able to see that there are two gates, one is AND and other one is OR, and how they are connected. I think even a layman can understand or see what is there in front of him. So gate level modeling becomes the layman's approach. Now if you actually see, gate level modeling and data flow approach are used maximum. Behavioral modeling is majorly used for sequential circuits. So where it is difficult to describe the connection, we use behavioral and data flow approach. Where it is easy to describe the connection, we use gate level approach. So depending on what circuit we are doing, we can select any one of the approach. So again, I am repeating, behavioral or algorithmic level, as they say, a module can be implemented in terms of the desired design algorithm without concerns for the hardware implementation details. So when you are writing the behavior, you don't have to worry whether a AND gate is there or a OR gate is there or a flip, it should do this. That is what you are specifying in the program. For this level, the truth level table and behavior of the circuit must be known. So behavior of the circuit can be best described in terms of truth table. Then the next approach that we have discussed is data flow approach, where the final function was required. In this approach, the module is designed by specifying the data flow. The designer is aware of how the data flows between hardware registers and how the data is processed in the design. For this level, the input and output relation must be known. That means you should be able to understand that AND is connected to one input of the OR gate. Hence, I can write the function in this particular way. So for that, that knowledge must be there. And the third level, that approach that we discussed, was the gate level. That is, the module is implemented in terms of logic gates and interconnections between these gates. It is implemented in terms of logic gates and implementation and interconnections between these gates. So when I use the word interconnections, you can expect that additional line, that is wire C. So in the gate exam, what they do is they will give you a program in which there is this statement wire C, D, E, F, G, H, whatever. So it will be a huge program in which this one, on one of the lines, this wire will be used. And then they will ask you which approach of Verilog programming is used in the above program, gate level, data flow, or behavioral. So that wire statement, you should know that this approach is a gate level modeling. By looking at assigned statements, you should be able to say that this is a data flow approach. And by looking at begin statements, you should be able to say that it is a behavioral approach. So again, I am repeating, by looking at wire statements, we should be able to say that it is a gate level modeling. By looking at assigned statements, we should be able to say that data flow level approach is used. And by looking at begin statements, we should be able to say that behavioral approach is used. So is this clear? Any questions in this, please unmute and ask me.
Hello.
Yes.
So what are those beginning statements?
Yes, I am coming to that. Behavioral model, I will be able to explain you only when I do a flip-flop circuit. So give me some time, I will come to that.
Okay, sir.
So please copy this. If you are done, just say done in the chat box so I come to know that it's done. So I want you to now see operator types in Verilog. I want you to see operator types in Verilogs. So Verilog operators. the different types of the very first one is arithmetic. The second one is logical. So logical means AND OR like that. AOI operation, AND OR inverter. Then we have relational, greater than or less than or equal to. Then we have equality, whether this is equal to, not equal to, equal to if, equal to, not equal to if. So that is called as equality. Then we have something called as bitwise. Then we have reduction operators. Then sometimes we need to do some shift operations. Shift operations. Then we have concatenation. We may want to concatenate one with another. Then we have replication. We may want to replicate a circuit. And then finally we have conditional. So what are these operators? So I want you to note down each operator so that you just get a practice of what these things are. So first you make a table like this, in which you will write operators, types, arithmetic. You can see multiply, divide, add, subtract. Then you have modulus and power. In logical, you have logical, negation, and OR. Please write this. Write this first three first. And most of the time, we will require arithmetic, logical, and relational. The first three only are majorly used in the programming. Others are not used that much. In some high level programming it may be used, but most of the times we use the first three: arithmetic, logic, and relational. So this forms the fundamental of something called as arithmetic and logic unit, that is ALU. A unit which can perform both arithmetic as well as logical operations is called as ALU, arithmetic. So many people also call it as CPU, that is central processing unit. But in today's context, over a period of around 50 years, we have now moved from ALU to CPU. So today we call it as GPU, that is graphic processing unit. But yes, it all started with ALU only, arithmetic and logic unit. So while you are writing, you can unmute and ask questions, no problem. So tomorrow's session will be a full-fledged session on only programming. So I will be doing around 9 to 10 programs. So I think that will be enough for you to give a gist of what Verilog programming is. And like I said, this is not the place where DLC will end. this is the place will now where now DLC will actually start. So you need to know the entire concepts of DLC to do programming in Verilog, which covers entire aspect of digital logic circuits. Please write done in the chat box once you are done with writing this. Okay, Gaurav, I will wait a couple of minutes so that all can copy this properly. For your exams, a laptop or a desktop is necessary because you have to run digital schematic on it. You cannot run DACH on mobile phone. So please make it available. If you are, if you do not have a laptop or a computer, no problem. You can use the e-pass facility of the college and come to college and give the exam. That's also fine. But in no case, mobile, if you are on mobile, there cannot be an exam. So is anybody having a, if anybody is having a problem regarding this part, just do a personal text to me or probably Uma madam, where she can help you out. And like I always say that you are an engineer and computer and laptop are your tools. So need not say, but you must have these things now. Of course, the cost part of it is not in your hands. So that concession can be given to you, but somewhere down the line you need to have it. Yes, Akshay, you want to say anything?
Sir, what kind of questions will be asked?
Yes, I'll come to that. So last 5 or 10 minutes we'll spend on this part, okay?
We'll okay,
just
sir.
Go through this and then we'll come to that. Okay, so let's see the other operator, that is equality and bitwise reduction. So Akshay's question was this. So if I am using it with a if statement, Akshay, then it will take it as a relational operator. Otherwise, it will take it as an assignment. Shubham Salvi. Okay, so this is bitwise, and finally you have got reduction. Concatenation, replication and conditional are just very typical. So, but again, they are put under operator types. Can you please? Okay. Vishwas, I think you can see that. Thank you. Okay. Okay, I think I'll just minimize this now and we'll go to the next part, that is number specifications. So there are two types of number specifications in Verilog. One is called as sized and the other one is called as unsized. So I'm just minimizing this. This is already there in your notes. I just wanted you to write at least the first three. So, number specifications. So, number specifications are of two types. One is sized, and the second one is unsized. So, when it comes to sized, the format is something like this. First, you specify the size, 4-bit, 12-bit, 16-bit, whatever. Then there is a typical symbol, which is like this. Then we have base format, whether it is binary, octal or hexadecimal, and then followed by the number. So if you want to specify a number, so if I write like this, 4, B 111, if I write it like this. So B stands for binary, 4 stands for size. So this is 4-bit binary number. It's a 4-bit binary number. If I write it like this, 12, H A B C, 12 H A B C. So one, each A, B and C is 4-bit, 4, 4, 4. So bits, how many bits will be there? 12. So that is why there are 12 bits. So we will write here 12-bit hexadecimal number. It's 12 bit long but hexadecimal, because one hexadecimal number is 4 bit long. So that is why number of bits in it is 12, and then what is given is ABC. If it would have been ABE, still it would have been the same. Now, if I write like this, 16B255. Now you can see here, this 255, even if you consider it as hexadecimal, they are 12 bit. So this D stands for decimal. That means 255 is represented using a 16-bit number. So that is why I write here 16-bit decimal number. 255 means 16 times 1. That is going to be 255. So there is a slight confusion that we are writing 12 bit, but we are writing hexadecimal. So can there be some other representation? So the answer is yes. So that is going to be unsized representation. So when it comes to unsized, the base format is simply, there is no size now. So we just write like this. Base format then the number. So that is simple. I can just write here. If I write here simply 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, nothing is mentioned. So by default, how many bits are there? So this is going to be, it's a default thing. Everything is 32 bit. So this is 32 bit decimal number. If I write B here, HB3, then this is going to be 32 bit X. And if I write here O71, that will be 32 bit octal. And you don't have to write here D, because D is also a part of hexadecimal. So when you don't write anything, it is understood that it is decimal. It is understood that it is a decimal number. When you don't write anything in front here, it is understood that it is a decimal. Otherwise, you simply write hex and octal. So many times we prefer unsized oversized because we don't have to mention the size. Whatever it is 32 bits. But the problem with that is then it consumes more memory. 32 bits will require more memory than 4 bits. So in the exam they may ask you, what is the primary advantage of using unsized numbers over size numbers? So yes, you don't have to specify the size, but the disadvantage of using unsized numbers is that since each representation is 32 bit long, the memory is going to be consumed more, because you can see that if I want to represent HB3, which is the second number which is on the screen, B and 3, B is 4 bit, 3 is also 4 bit. So in all, I require only 8 bits to represent this number. But it will append 24 zeros in front of this B and 3, and it will store it as a 32-bit decimal number. So those 24 bits become excessively large as compared to the number itself. If you are dealing with very big numbers, then go for unsized representations, because you will anyways require more number of bits if you want to represent big numbers. So unsized will be better that time as compared to sized ones. So that's how we use it. How to actually make the actual use will be more clear in the program. So just for information, this is there, but how to actually use it, we'll see it in the program. So I will stop here. It is 4 minutes to 4. And before I just stop recording, do not log out. Some very important instructions I have to give with regards to exam.